let's have prayer. We're going to get right into the Luke chapter number 16, verses 1 through 13. The unjust steward, the unjust steward. Now, next week, we will be starting a series of fundamental lessons for our people right here in the auditorium. We will be passing things out. That's why he's in that position, or that's why he has that area to cover. So God knows what you and I are able to do. That's why we have the positions we have, and that's why some of us do not have the positions that we desire. And so God, or the Master, if you would, is looking here at his servant and understands that he's looking at him going, if you would, I expected better out of you. You were able to perform better out of you. That's why you had the position that you had. When we do not use that which God has given to us, we disappoint him, if you would. We disappoint, like here, of the unjust steward with his master. He looked at him and asked him simply, how is it that I hear this of you? I shouldn't be hearing this about you. Think about your own life. Now, I am not just listening more and more to what people keep saying. We just need teachers. Folks, listen. The Bible is always teaching. But the Bible also points out what we're doing right and what we're doing wrong. Okay? So if I'm an unjust steward, he didn't look at me and say, oh, no, man, let's just learn together. No, he pointed out to him because he was displeased with him. Right? And so please understand the same thing with us. We are stewards of God's stuff. Not just in church, at your home, with your life, with your health, with your abilities, with your talents. God gave those to you. So, number three, he perhaps did not take into account that he must give account of his stewardship. We tend to forget this, don't we? We tend to walk through life and work through life from one day to the next, like it'll just be almost endless. But there comes a time, look at verse number two, he said, give an account of thy stewardship. Now remember, stewardship is that which was given to you by someone else to watch over and take care of and make sure that it's handled properly, all right? And now he's saying, you must be this time to give an account. And so what happens here, each of us must face the Lord one day. Most Christians know this. And again, we're not talking about our eternal life or our eternal destination. That is settled when we, at the cross, when we receive Jesus as our Savior. So here, if we have the ability to sing, and we did not use it, for example, in church, but like many do today, they can't wait to get out on the Country and Western Trail, or on the Rap Trail, or on the I Wish I Was a Rock and Roll Singer Trail, and whatever gift you have, which most of them, I don't think they have gifts anyway, but they do, they go out there, and what you've done, God gave you something for his use. You are a steward of his stuff, and now you're using it for the world. That's unjust. You should not be doing that. Or let's say that a person does have the ability to make money. A lot of people get passed upon. Trust me, they go through churches like water running downhill sometimes. They come to church, they don't have anything, they can't make ends meet, they're not really sure about life. All of a sudden, God gives them the courage they need, begins to impart into them greater things in their stewardship. The next thing you know, somebody out in the world will say, wow, you're really good. And we forgot it was God that allowed us to do that or gave that to us. And off we go trying to make more money and please our earthly boss. I'm not saying don't work for them. You work for somebody, you give them your bills. But you have to remember whose steward you are. That boss on the job is not your steward. He is your, according to the Bible, your master or your boss at that time. That's all. That's all that he is. But even there, God says, work as unto the Lord. We're supposed to work that way. Let's assume for a minute that you have the ability to play a musical instrument. I'm shocked. Seriously, I really am at the lack of piano players anymore or organists. This was a constant battle. Just a few decades ago, everybody raised their kid to play a musical instrument. Now we don't have time. Now look at the quandary. Look at the problem we've run into. Churches, many of them have no musical instrument players at all. And yet we find out that there are people in our own crowd that can play it. They just don't want to. To them, it's a waste of time. They don't want to put in the effort. If you have an ability to do that, you need to work on your ability, and you need to use that ability for the Lord. Why? Because you're a steward that belongs to God. It's not just the preacher. It's every one of us. We have a talent. Whatever that talent is, my dear friend, please, quit listening to the allurement of the world saying, you know, you can make more. You know, you can do more. Is that all you ever want to be? Really? Do you remember where God found you? Do you know what you have now? Do you know what he's interested in you? Do you know how much he's done for you? Really? And somehow the world, how turn you again to the weak and beggarly elements of the world? It just, I know the temptation's there, but when you've stand them side by side, oh my goodness, one far outweighs the other by eternity. At the judgment seat, all of us must give an account of what we have done, while being in possession of God's house or God's people. And your body belongs to God. Right? So we go out there and pump iron and eat all kinds of food. I'm not necessarily against that. But bodily exercise profits live. He's talking about eternal things. Take care of yourself, sure. Be completely obese and don't care if you ever exercise or ever work or anything like that. No, no, folks, no, don't pendulum, go from one extreme to the other. Simply says, this belongs to Him, your spirit belongs to Him, these buildings belong to Him, this work belongs to Him, your talent belongs to Him, and God is saying there's coming a day that we must give an account of our stewardship. Again, He's not just talking to the preacher, He's talking to all of us. God knows what your part of the field is and what His expectation, and He has given you the ability, the talent to handle that area for Him. Number four. Go down to verse number 16. What's this? What shall I do? He waited late in life to become too concerned. Now, this fellow, this is true, and I don't necessarily like to bring this up, but it is true. He waited late in life to be concerned. In verse number 3, he said, what shall I do? Now, the day of reckoning came, the time for justification came, counting up and giving account of his stewardship had come about. The tragic thing is that many people do not serve the Lord in their youth. You look at most churches, I'm not talking about teenagers, really, I'm spoken of in the Bible. They're young adults, young men and women. We find out here that young men and women, a lot of times we get so caught up, I think as Timothy talks about, not becoming entangled again in this world. Specifically, do the word say, he's talking about business. Business has a way of just wrapping us up until we don't have time for Sunday night service, we don't have time for midweek service, we don't have time to be soul winning, we don't have time to work in junior church, we don't have time to be in choir, we don't have any of this time to do anything. And that's when we have all of our energy, we have all of our strength, we have all of our mental capacity, we have so much to offer back to the Lord that He has put into us. How sad it is that many people waste those years of trying to impress the world and get ahead in the world and do more for the world. Do you understand? If you just serve the Lord, even Joseph, God took care of him. Moses, God took care of him. Paul, God took care of him. Please understand, we've got to start turning our mind and heart eternity, toward eternity, not the temporal down here. And so what happens here is this. He simply waited too long after wasting his Lord's substance. Everything that he wasted it. And he had lots of opportunity. The Lord could show him, hey, I'm back. He said, look, after a long time, I'm coming back. I will return. He's told us. Preachers have preached. Moms and dads have told their kids, the Lord's coming back someday. And now we have put that off and put that off and put that off until we wait until we're older. Now, listen, help. Those of us that came to the Lord later in life, I'm not speaking about you. You did not have youthfulness as a Christian to give that to the Lord. Okay? You couldn't do that. But you did. You were lost, dead in trespasses and sins, and you got saved later on in life. Do what you can while you can. But here, this man had a more of an opportunity when he was younger, and he wasted all of that. And he waited too long to stop and think about it. And for many of us, when we get older, we think about it, you know, maybe I ought to start doing something for God. You know, maybe I ought to get involved in church. Maybe, guess I was 50, 60, 70 years old. So what happens is that he gives himself to God. Now, it's far better if we could, if we can, to begin to be used, our talents, our money, our efforts, our strength, when we're still young. Serve thy Creator in the days of thy youth before the evil days come. Now, I think those evil days, you can take it the way you want to, I believe those evil days is getting old. We all know getting old is wonderful, really, so you can still build like you used to. You could still run and go like he used to, still put in many hours like he used to. Folks, listen to me. There comes a time when desire may be great, and physical body says, he's so great. And so we find out that we can't serve the Lord like we want to. And so I think while we can, take account of your own stewardship. Are you giving yourself to the Lord? Are you living for the Lord? Are you following the Lord? Are you obeying the Lord? Are you producing for the Lord? Take account of your own stewardship of what God has given you before God comes and says, can you even see what all you've done for me when I was gone? It's what happened, okay? Now, go down to verse number 3 again. So once all of this came on him and he finally realized, I haven't been producing like I should. I haven't been handling things like I should. And so he begins to, later on in his life, after all of this has happened, and it was trying to settle up, so to speak, he gets to thinking, okay, this is not turning out good at all. What am I going to do? So he says this, I cannot dig. Now, whether he's lazy or because of his age, he's not going to go out and get a physical job. It saddens my heart, and I understand. Okay, you take Samson. Okay, I'm just preaching on Samson not long ago. Samson was a man of God, a judge of God, a man filled with the Spirit of God, a man greatly used of God. Do you know where he ended up? Taking all that he had left that God gave him and working out in the world with him. At the end of his life, he was working out in the world, pushing around a great big stone, grinding wheat for the enemy. Just grinding wheat, wasting his time, putting in his 40, 50 hours, thinking he's really doing something that matters maybe, and just going round and round in circles. And here we have the same thing. He said, I cannot dig. Maybe the guy was just lazy. That's implied because he's not using his Lord's stuff the way he should have. Why didn't he get busy? Why didn't he apply it? Why didn't he use it? Maybe he was just flat lazy. He was too old to work. He said, I can't dig. Maybe just too lazy. He's too lame, but the truth is he was just too lazy to go to work. Laziness. Do you remember when he's talking about the talents? He said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. But remember the last one? He gave his talent. He's called him lazy, slothful, right? Slothful is a sin. Laziness is a sin. It's wrong. And you know, in today's society, we take words like lazy. Just have a hard time getting up. They have a hard time working. Well, they're just slow at what they do. And I'm sure the Lord's really entertained by those excuses. Right? It's like we say, okay, it wasn't really up to the head. Why? Where in the Bible do we go from lines of sin to it's not that bad? If this is what we're doing, we're getting accustomed to not looking at sin the way God tells us to look at sin. And the same thing here with our stewardship. Well, I'm just not one of those that really get involved, ladies and gentlemen. You do not need to get involved on the level somebody else does. Everybody has a part, has a stewardship that they have received something from God. And again, I don't care if it's money, talent, a calling to preach, working in sound room, being an usher, giving yourself, helping someone else. All of us have talent. Everybody has a talent of some kind. So he got to looking at things. In verse number 16, he said, I cannot dig. I can't dig. But either he was lazy or he was so old, he said, well, I'm going to do now. If I'm not able to watch over my master's stuff, that means I have to go out here and get a job. I have to go out here. And let's admit, when you leave the level you're at, many of us are here in a church like this, you know where you're going to go when you go out in the world? Bottom of the road and start all over again. So, then he says this. In verse number 4 through 7. What's it say? Go down to verse number 4. I am resolved what to do. That when I am put out, he said, look, I'm losing this. I'm getting ready to get put out. I can't get it. Now watch what he says here. He said, in my stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him and said unto the first, how much owest thou my Lord? There's a misunderstanding about this. I'm going to watch this. In verse number 6, he said, 100 measures of oil. He said unto him, said, "Oh, come on, spirit." And he said to number eight, verse 7, then said he unto another, "How much owest thou?" And he answered, 100 measures of wheat. He said unto him, "Take thy bill and write fourscore, or 80, for 80 instead of 100. And the Lord commended the unwise steward, commended and unwise. And that can seem to flow right out. How do you commend someone for being unwise? Because we misunderstand what's being said here. Watch, watch. Because he had done wisely. Well, when did he do wisely? Well, I'll try to explain this in a second. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. Now, listen very carefully. He said he was too proud to beg. He said, I can't do this. Now, if you read this story very, very carefully, you're going to notice that there are some terrible things that he did. This ledger was not his. What was owed his master was not up to him to make that judgment. He said, but he commended him. They said, commend means to praise or to compliment. Okay, but watch what happens here. He was dishonest in his master's money. First of all, before it come time to reckon the whole thing, he wasn't handling his stewardship right. Now you mean to tell me his master's going, you know, you did really good. No, he already getting ready to get kicked out of his stewardship. He didn't handle it right. He basically accused him of being lazy and not handling things the way you're supposed to. And now if we're not careful, we read into this like, hey, he's commending him for being really sharp about how he decided to do that. That's not what he's doing at all. Now listen very carefully here. Look down at verse number 8. The hollow condemnation is what it is. It's not a commendation. He's looking at him and saying to him, look at verse number 8. Look at verse number 8. And the Lord commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. What do you mean he did wisely? You see, he went to somebody that owed the master and took his master's bill and told that guy, you don't owe that much. You owe half of it. I'm sure the guy that he told that to was very pleased. But the steward had no right to do with his master's stuff what he wanted. He worked for his master. He didn't work for himself. Then the next one he came along, he said, you owe 100. Okay, now you only owe 80. I'm sure the guy that owed 100, and now just like that, owed 80. I bet he felt real good about himself. But understand, the Lord was talking to his servant about not handling his stewardship properly. He basically, and then the steward said, look, I can't go out and beg. I'm either too old, I'm too lazy, I'm too... I think he's probably lazy because he wasn't even handling his own stewardship right. He hadn't made everything I had. I didn't have to fuss and fight over. Belongs to him. All I do is handle it the way he wants. And he didn't do that. So what happens here is this: many people misconstrue this commendation as teaching that God was pleased with this man. God wasn't pleased with this man. The master was not pleased with his stewardship. This is not true, because the succeeding verses will teach that he commended him only for his shrewdness to take care of his physical needs. The guy's getting ready to go out of a great, if you would, job. Let me see if my master supplies things. He knows what I'm able to do. He's asked me to do this. I've been with him for some time. Pretty cush job, if you would. It's amazing how many Christians we were struggling in the world, fighting for everything, not making ends meet. In a taskmaster's situation, we come to the Lord, things become peaceful, we begin to advance, and all of a sudden we get lazy about the whole thing. Do you understand there's come a reckoning day? And so what happens, and by the way, every year goes by, we're getting older. We're losing our position in the world, and you get saved, they lose contact with you. So it's not like I've been here 15 years, and that 15 years want to transfer over to some business downtown. It doesn't work that way. This man looked at me and said, man, I can't go out and get a physical job. I'm just like too lazy. I don't even know how to do that. I've been in this position so long, I had it made. I can't do that, man. So he goes through the ledger and he starts calling people in and saying, listen, he's not going to want you to do something. How much have you owed? And I pulls out this slip and starts calling people in and paying what they owe his master. And so what's happened here is the lord of the steward was simply saying, you've been pretty sharp when it comes to taking care of yourself. When it comes time for you to have to go out there, you may have been holding them to have to pay these bills and follow these rules and do what they're told, and now you're going to be under them or with them. That's not going to work very good. So he was smart enough that when it came to taking care of himself, his physical needs, he's going to run ahead of time, because he's going to lose his job here. He's going to run ahead of time and say, hey, look, I'm going to give you a break on your bill, okay? I'll write this out. That guy come in, hey, I'm going to give you a big break on your bill, okay? And so what he's doing with now, he's concerned about him. He's concerned about his livelihood. He's concerned about his physical life. And so he began, the Lord looked at him and said, oh, I think, so when it comes to you, you're pretty wise, aren't you? You're wise when it comes to taking care of yourself. He wasn't commending him on handling business the way he should. He was saying, what means more to you is your physical life and stuff that takes place on you. Because when you were working for me, you lost sight of the eternal. You lost sight of the real purpose. You lost sight of who it was you're working for. You lost sight of it. Like it didn't matter to you anymore. Now, one decision, oh, I can't use you anymore, you immediately start using the good sense that God gave you, the wisdom that God gave you, the business sense God gave you. You didn't pull that out of a sock somewhere. God gave you that. And I can prove it because we have a lot of people who have left church. You know, we're not making ends meet. Oh, well, you know, it's a little tougher than I expect. Oh, get over it. You're a steward for the Lord. He takes care of you. But you keep your eye on the world and look how they're prospering. And we get the whining and feeling sorry as if to say our master's not fair. We decide to stop and get a little lazy at what we're doing. I mean, after all, we're not making the kind of money we deserve. And so this guy looks out, finds that the master says, we can't go on this way. I've heard some things about you. And it's not right. And to prove that you could have, because when it comes time to taking care of yourself, you're pretty shrewd. You're pretty sharp. When it comes time to take care of you, you seem to be pretty sharp. What a tragedy that most of us spend our time, our effort, our talents. Where man's treasure is, there will his heart be. Maybe that's the underlying problem right there. Maybe he was making ends meet. And working for someone else, I mean, what I have to show for it, right? It's what a lot of people enter into the ministry. I don't want to go full time. So can I have health insurance? Can I make $60,000 a year, $80,000 a year? Can we live in a nice place? What are you talking about? You're trying to take what the world says you're deserving of. And your master in heaven doesn't know what you need. There's something wrong with it. And so we begin to get a little lazy. Telling you one of these days we're going to have to answer for all that. What we ought to really be concerned about are the spiritual needs, the eternal things we lost sight of. Evidently, he didn't fit. Because, in my opinion, this man had a great opportunity to just keep serving his master. And when he came to it, he would have rewarded him. But he got his reward or lost their part. And then finally, God tells us how we should handle our secular affairs. Now watch this. We find out in verse number 16, make to yourselves the friends of mammon of unrighteousness. Now again, we misunderstand that. See, I'm supposed to be able to get all I can out in the world, and I need to be friends with all these people. What he's saying here is this, that people of the world seem to be smarter than we are sometimes. And we're supposed to have the wisdom of God. You know what God is saying? He's not saying here, be real smart in business, be real smart in this, give yourself only to that, show how God can work with businessmen or how God can work with athletes. What he's simply saying here, the same thing to this person right here, he's saying, look, do you know how to handle affairs out here? Are those people smarter than you are? I was talking to someone the other day, and they said, preacher, you won't believe this. I make certain statements at work. They say, start teaching that to everybody. Like, it's a brand new concept. And they looked at me and smiled and said, it's just what we were taught when we were in church. How many people, men and women, that are here and or left here, or other churches, are using what the master gave the steward, the tools he needed to do the work that he gave them. And now they are no longer here and getting all of that out there in the world somewhere. We are to work hard. We're supposed to work for that person out there. Like we're working for the Lord, we're supposed to do that. We are to expect a fair wage. We're supposed to give good 8 hours or 10 hours or whatever the case may be. We are to pay our debts. I'm talking about that. I'm not talking about internal things. I'm talking about out there. We're supposed to do that. Christians are certainly to be honest, considerate, and wise in spiritual matters, just like they should be out there. So what he's saying is this guy knows how to work in the world. He knows how to get leverage. He knows how to pull favor. He knows how to do good to others so that hopefully they'll do good. So we all know these things. And you talk to people on the job, you say, hey, you got a Christian. Why didn't you recognize him? Because what he has done, he's real good on his job. She's real good at what she does. And many of those people know what they should be doing for their real master. No, they should be working hard. No doubt about it. They should be paying their debts. They should outwork other people, not to show them up just because they're a Christian and serve the Lord. We are to transfer this diligence, this honesty, this thing about spiritual matters, the way we work there. Why don't we do that here? Why don't we do that in our family? Why don't we do that with what God has called us to do? You would work overtime. You would stay late. You would show up early. You would do what you need to do. You would teach others. You would lose sleep. You'd stay at it all night long. And here, we don't show church on Sunday. This is what God wants us to do. So he was simply saying, I know you know better. Because you've already taken stuff that belongs to me and said, oh, come on, take care of myself. And you knew how, didn't you? You knew how. So you knew what you should have been doing for me. You should have been doing all these things for me. We are to transfer this diligence and honesty to spiritual matters. Had this man been as diligent for his master, started thinking and applying himself because he said, now I have to take care of me. And look what he did. He started gaining favor from people he knew he was going to have to go out and live alone. Boy, had he only done that when he was with the Lord. He commends us. The diligence of people have made money oftentimes, hours, days, weeks, years, months, spent in shrewd dealings and putting in the hours and doing all these things, and yet, if this isn't you, don't worry about it. We come in half-hearted. I listened to someone long ago when they said, oh, right now, churches are not essential. Oh, we bristle at that. We bristle at that. Oh, my goodness, now the churches are essential. And many of the same people that say that, the days of the covenant church, show up late half the time, tithe whenever we can afford it, don't really witness to anybody, I skip church every other week, whatever the case may be, really essential, you sure? And the Lord says we are. But are we showing the Lord how we show you flip flops and no ties and how they make a good Christian? If you're the head of a business, you ain't showing the business anyway. You know that's the truth. So he's saying that God's business should be run as effectively and as efficiently as any business that's out there. This is not a world corporation. This is not a worldly business. This is a spiritual business. But it should be approached the same way as if this business were your business and you wanted to make it a success. You understand? This steward, no, this wasn't his business. It belonged to somebody else. But he was working with and for this guy. And what he should have done was the way that he knew. Because even before he left this job, boy, he was setting himself up already. Because he knew, I can't get and get a labor's job. I'm too lazy. I'm too old. I don't know what the problem is. We find ourselves the wisdom that God gave many of us when we were under His stewardship. To see. So don't take this as, you know, the Lord kind of commanded him, but here's what we do. God gets to understand why the Lord commanded him, because it seems to me like, why don't he commanded him? Because he was smart. He commanded him for saying, I'm pretty smart for you to look out for yourself. He said it right. He said, you have a lot of smarts to defend. Boy, had you only done that when you were with me. Think what could happen. Ladies and gentlemen, there's an unjust steward. Unjust. Why do you think God put that in the Bible? Because it will end up on anybody who can't do this. Please, take it down on yourself. I will say, if we judge ourselves, we save ourselves from judgment. So let's do what's right, okay? Good to have you with us this morning. We'll see you in a few moments.